Dear friends and book lovers, Red Rising Cordilleras, the novel of Rudy T. Lipurada, has for its panoramic background the entire Cordilleras, including Baguio City, the villages of Cordillera, the resource-rich valleys and heights. The fluid field of the People's War, conducted by the New People's Army under the leadership of the Communist Party of the Philippines. The people of the Cordilleras are fortunate because of their natural riches, but these are at the same time the cause of their misfortune when foreign aggressors like Spanish colonialism and U.S. imperialism and the Filipino reactionaries covet and grab such riches for their own profit. By their own resistance, the Igorot tribes of the Cordilleras overcame their differences to unite against Spanish colonialism and prevent it from grabbing all the gold mines. They joined up with the Filipino revolutionaries of 1896, including the Ilocanos and Tagalogs, to put an end to Spanish colonialism. But U.S. imperialism interrupted the revolution by unleashing its war of conquest. It came to the Cordilleras with troops trained in massacring Indians and using far superior military forces to grab the gold mines and other natural riches, and to deploy the American religious missionaries and the primary public school system. The historical period of the novel is specifically the years of Marcos' rule, before and after the 1972 declaration of martial law under the semi-colonial and semi-feudal ruling system. The novel draws life and intensity from the social and personal conflicts arising from the brutal Marcos regime and its scheme to put up a mega hydroelectric dam project in collaboration with the World Bank in order to sweep away the homes, farms, hunting grounds, and burial grounds of the Igorot tribes to benefit the exploiting classes beyond the Cordilleras. The village of Chidlawan becomes the initial focus of attention in the novel as it brings together Pangat Lakay Samang, his granddaughter Lumayang, who has just returned from her studies in the city, and a new incoming parish priest, Father Carlo Paterno. As a student in the city, Lumayang has become connected to the National Democratic Revolution and to the New People's Army expanding in the Cordilleras. She is tasked to facilitate the entry of the New People's Army to her village, and she is suspicious of the Catholic priest, Father Carlo, as a clerical fascist. The novelist uses a series of surprise twists in an ironic manner to keep his reader riveted to the book. In the first of surprise twists, Father Carlo proves himself a devoted priest and servant to his parishioners, and ultimately wins the heart of Lumayang after proving himself in confronting and outwitting the military officer of an enemy team in search of the NPA. Father Carlo is the first of three young Baguio City friends to be in the countryside of the Cordilleras, to be with the people, even if at first in the service of his God. The two other friends are Noel Altamonte and Julius Madrigal. The novel interweaves the trajectories of their lives and connect them to the rising of the people of the Cordilleras and the struggle of the NPA. Noel is the son of a successful and well-to-do doctor of medicine. He drives his own car and is happy-go-lucky, but becomes a Kabatang Makabayan activist and revolutionary against the wishes of his well-to-do parents. Julius Madrigal is a cadet of the Philippine Military Academy and is bound to become a commissioned officer of the reactionary armed forces. After the proclamation of martial law in 1972, Noel Altamonte and his wife Lina are compelled to join the NPA and do mass work in the countryside. But after some time, he decides to return to the city due to his physical difficulties and due to the pregnancy of his wife, which he thinks would be better taken care of in the city. He falls into the trap set by his own uncle, Captain George Altamonte, who arrests him and Lina and proves incapable of protecting them from the orders of General Tobias to torture them. Noel withstands the torture for a while until he sees his wife abused by the military torturers and decides to collaborate with the enemy. Lieutenant Julius Madrigal is assigned by his superiors to take charge of the arrest and safe house detention and torture of a leader of the revolutionary movement, Jose Saludo, his former beauty queen wife, Lilian Gomez, and a woman companion. After the escape of Saludo from the safe house and the rape and murder of the two women by his sergeant subordinate, Julius is scapegoated by his superiors, charged and imprisoned as the rapist murderer. While in prison, he is eventually contacted by his friend, Father Carlo, through Sister Aurencia to join the NPA and escape from prison. By this time, Carlo has become the NPA leader, Alinao, after being tagged by the enemy as communist cooperating with the NPA. Embittered by the false charges of his superiors, Julius agrees to join the NPA and escape from prison. Before the escape, he receives revolutionary education from a fellow political prisoner, Arnulfo. The novelist uses the conversion of Julius to being a revolutionary and NPA commander to show how the correct strategy and tactics of the People's War have led to the expansion of the NPA from Central Luzon to other regions. Liburada also uses the dream of Julius as literary device to depict him as the biblical Joshua, teaming up with Carlos Moses against the Ethiopians and then the Egyptians. After escaping from prison with other comrades, Julius reunites with his friends Carlo and Noel in the countryside. He assumes the nom de guerre Paolo. He uses to the advantage of the NPA his knowledge of the enemy's strategy and tactics. The three friends work together well in the revolutionary movement until the return of Noel and Lina to the city. As a result of Noel's capture, torture and betrayal, the enemy succeeds in encircling the camp of Carlo and Julius. The enemy military officer Julius dies as a revolutionary martyr by diving on a grenade thrown by the enemy in order to save Carlo and others. The novel ends with vengeance exacted against the revolutionary turned renegade Noel by armed city partisans in the garb of two nuns, one of whom is Sister Aurencia, who is Julius's beloved. Noel is depicted as the example of the upper petty bourgeoisie who loves the comforts and fun of belonging to a well-to-do family, becomes a KM activist, and makes the effort to become a revolutionary, but breaks at some point because he cannot stand the rigors of struggle, torture, and the threat of death. I commend the novelist for reflecting and putting life into the revolutionary struggle of the Igorots, the NPA in the countryside, and the Kabataang Makabayan, and the social and personal circumstances and peculiarities of the characters. His characterizations are credible because they are concrete and probable. I also commend the language and style of Liburada. He uses poetic language in describing the natural landscape of the Cordilleras. At the same time, he commands the pace of his narrative by using the crispy prose of Hemingway and the journalist. He is also fond of ending a chapter with a short sentence to imply or indicate the outcome of a previous narration of events. Only a master storyteller can use such a device. A lesser writer would make a long explication. The novel is excellent material for a film filled with overwhelming landscapes and dramatic figures in dramatic situations of life and death, social and personal conflicts, and romances such as those of Carlo and Lumayang, Julius and Aurencia, and even of the ill-fated Noel and Lina. I recommend that you read, enjoy, and learn from the book first before you expect to watch an audiovisual version of it. There is already a movie script of the novel and deserves the attention of a serious producer. It is best to take hold of the book now, savor its full substance and style, and thereafter brace up for the film to be produced in due time. Thank you.